नमस्कार। आज गणतंत्र दिवस रिपब्लिक डे पे मैं चरणजीत चंद्रपाल एडवोकेट सब लोगों को बधाई देता हूँ। आई कॉन्ग्रेचुलेट दिस नेशन एंड द रिपब्लिक ऑफ इंडिया फॉर दिस 26 जनवरी रिपब्लिक डे। दिस डे वॉज फर्स्ट गिवन टू अस ऑन 26 जनवरी 1950। टुडे आई वॉन्ट टू एड्रेस टू इशूज़। दो इशूज़ का हम आज थोड़ी बहुत चर्चा करेंगे। द फर्स्ट इशू इज़ द सिटीजनशिप अमेंडमेंट एक्ट। द सिटीजनशिप अमेंडमेंट एक्ट हैज़ बीन एनेक्टेड मेनली टू गिव रिफ्यूज टू हिंदूज, सिक्स, बुद्धिस्ट्स, पारसीज एंड क्रिश्चियंस who are seeking refuge in India. It will benefit 31,313 people, mainly Hindus and Sikhs, who have been facing persecution in Islamic fanatic countries. Question now arises as to why this applicability has not been made to the Muslims and the constitutional validity of this move by the government. With respects, I may say that keeping in mind the entire facts and circumstances of the situation that the country has been undergoing for the past 3 decades, right since the eruption of the problem of Kashmir took place and took a very ugly turn in the early 90s, is that the move is correct. It is constitutionally valid. And we must all support with thumping majority to the present government for introducing such a strong and a proper move towards a better India. The Muslims need not worry about their nationality. Enough safeguards have been taken in the act. Time limits of the year of 1971 have been placed. There is no question as to why a Muslim should fear if he is actually a proper national of India. Now let us see the practical situation. Infiltrators who came in from Pakistan took refuge of fake Aadhaar cards, took refuge of fake passports. Some of them stayed in India and even did the serial killings in 1993. In 2008, the Ajmal Kasab killings that took place on 26th November 2008. Now, keeping in mind this kind of an infiltration, which is mainly taken from Pakistan, from Afghanistan, from those states where the Hizbul Mujahideen, the IMI, as well as the Taliban are active, from those states like Bangladesh, wherein infiltrators have flocked this country and are now constituting illegal votaries and vote banks for vested political parties. Now, in order to curb them, there has to be necessarily a law which will concentrate on a particular religion, because most of the people who are coming in as illegal infiltrators are from these 2 or 3 countries surrounding our country. And that is the reason why the CAA is necessary. I have been hearing a lot of nonsensical slogans that why India should not be called Hindustan. My question to all these people are, we are belonging to a civilization which started from the Indus Valley. The original religion of the Indus Valley was Hinduism. The Pathans and the Mughals could not pronounce it as Hindu. So that is the reason why the word Indu instead of Hindu started taking place. A native religion, which is Hinduism, which has invited and tolerated all other religions in our country, is supposed to be called by that name. By calling Hindustan, we are not encouraging any kind of religious intolerance. In fact, Hinduism connotes tolerance. There is no question why a person should not call Hindustan as Hindustan. It is Hindustan. We now come to the second issue, which was actually first taken by the government on the 5th of August 2019. The issue relates to the abrogation of Article 370 of the Constitution. Article 370 in the first place has not been deleted. I do not see any reason why the government should not completely delete it. Article 370, first let us see what is the history behind the move of the government and what the government still needs to do in that. At the Supreme Court, there were 10 petitions filed, beginning with a petition of Mr. Manohar Lal Sharma, along with 8 other petitions. The petitions were first heard in 2 batches, one on the aspect of the suspension of internet services and the cellular services ban in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. And the second issue was on the constitutional validity of the move of abrogating Article 370 vis-a-vis changes in Article 368 and 369 of the Constitution of India. In all these matters, my NGO, the Nitya Law Society, and myself, we have intervened in all these applications in support of the Government of India. A suspension of cellular services or suspension of internet for a short span of time do not constitute any violation of a fundamental right. On 10th January 2020, that is this year, a 3-bench judgment of the Supreme Court of India, headed by Honorable Justice N.V. Ramanna, was pronounced, and the entire law relating to telecommunication services has been discussed. Although it says that there cannot be a blanket ban on the ban of telecommunication services, the order clearly spells out that for a limited period, for keeping in mind security measures, the telephone services can be banned. In Jammu and Kashmir, the landlines were working, the hospital services were actually working. I have been myself witness to these proceedings in 3 extensive hearings, which though I did not do it myself, I did intervene and made my points clear to the Supreme Court. Now we come to the abrogation of Article 370. First, let us understand how Kashmir came to be a part of India. For that, one has to go to the origination of the state of Kashmir and the first annexation to the Indian subcontinent. For that, one has to understand how Kashmir first became part of Punjab, which was made by Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Years ago, in the late 1970s, Kashmir came to be conquered by the Sikh kingdom of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. The kingdom extended from borders of Balochistan, Afghanistan, Multan, Sindh, Punjab, Haryana, up to Kashmir. The entire Dogra clan fell in a war to Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Maharaja Ranjit Singh then in turn appointed governors for taking care of the state of Kashmir. After the expiry of Maharaja Ranjit Singh in or about 1815, the Britishers reconquered the state of Kashmir because the Dogras, the dynasty of Dogras, the Singh, Gopal Singh, he basically wanted to disassociate from the Sikh dynasty. An Amritsar Treaty was signed by the Sikhs, giving Kashmir to the Britishers. The Britishers could not handle Kashmir because of the geographic problems, glaciers, ice, hilly regions, and that is the reason why, leaving apart defense, communication and foreign trade, the entire management was given to Gopal Singh. After that, in or about 1845 or so, Prakash Singh, the lineal descendant of Gopal Singh, came to be the ruler on fixed terms and conditions. This special status that we are talking about is because of the geographic locations, because the Britishers could not handle it. After Gopal Singh, when Prakash Singh took Even then, some powers were taken away from Prakash Singh, which he objected. And finally, Mr. Hari Singh, he became the person who was ruling Kashmir. When India declared, when there was a partition declared between India and Pakistan, at that time, Hari Singh gave a treaty to Lord Mountbatten, who had ceased to become Viceroy, and he was the governor at that time. That is how the question of governor and constituent assembly came to the picture. He accepted the treaty and accepted Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh as part of India. The region of Leh was left. The agreement does not mention about Leh. That's the reason why Leh is neither of Tibet, neither of China, nor of India, nor of Pakistan. That's the reason why China is claiming to the regions of Leh. Now, in 1950, there were two constitutional orders passed. One constitutional order was Constitutional Order 10, Article 10. And after that, we have Article 35A, which is a constitutional order by the president. It's not a part of the constitution. So for removing Article 35A, one does not have to amend the constitution of India. One has to simply, a president simply has to withdraw it. This special status was given only as a transitory and a temporary provision under Article 370. The part under of the constitution in which it falls is transitory and temporary provision, and that temporary provision can be withdrawn at any time. The governor of the particular state was in rules. A question of taking any permission from the constituent assembly does not arise. Now, when India itself was divided into India and Pakistan, prior to that, there was a proposal by Lord Wavell, the previous Viceroy of the Indian subcontinent. And the proposal was that India would be given to the Muslim League and the Indian National Congress to be governed except to the extent of defense, communication and foreign trade. This proposal was rejected by the INC. And India came to be divided as India and Pakistan. And one cannot go back to a policy. And the decision itself to grant special status to Kashmir was erroneous, because we have already rejected the cabinet mission plan, which preserved the rights of defense, communication, foreign trade to British. So how can we give it to J&K? Since there was a problem of the representation in J&K, this special status was given with a separate constitution. Now, over a period of time, in 1971, we had the Shimla Agreement, where the disputed area, which we call the Azad Kashmir or the Pakistan Occupied Kashmir, is already with them. What Article 370 abrogation meant was they are not touching the POK. Neither are they touching the Siachen Glacier or the Aksai Chin Glacier or any of those seven valleys. They are simply consolidating Kashmir and Ladakh with themselves, which is a right of the country. And both these states have been accumulated. What the thing has to be done now? Only thing which the government has failed to do up till now, which we are also pressing for in an interview and application at the Supreme Court, is that there should be declaration of borders. The borders of Kashmir and Ladakh should be declared, which have not yet been declared. Question of granting special status does not arise at all. It was a temporary provision. Now, coming to the aspect of the Muslim majority, let me tell you, right since the days Kashmir was annexed, I mean it, right since the days Kashmir was annexed to Maharaja Ranjit Singh's kingdom, thereafter even when Gopal Singh, Prakash Singh and Hari Singh were ruling, the Muslims over there never had any representation. We as India, being a democratic state, granted them representation. I am not against Muslims. I am only on the question of those people who are making it an issue of Hinduism and Islam. Nothing of that sort I am touching. I am talking about facts which geography speaks, facts which history speaks, and facts which are recorded statistics. So we per se as India, we per se as Hindustan, have granted them enough of representation. And if the state has to spend crores of rupees on defense, crores of rupees on maintenance of refugees, crores of rupees on daily warfare to be done. It is better that the state is accommodated. When the judiciary is ours, when all the supplies are ours, why should there be a special status to a place which is already divided and an Azad Kashmir has been given to them? Question of redividing and granting further special status does not arise. It is a move which is in betterment of the country. It is a move which will make the country have less financial burdens. It is a move which will curb terrorism, and it is a move which is supplementary to the Citizenship Amendment Act, because many of the infiltrators who have come in Kashmir, Punjab, as well as in Ladakh from that region will be removed as a result of this move. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.